there, and welcome once again to the weekly peek into the lives of the rich and famous, seen only on the Weekend Edition. Coming up on this week's show, it's happening, and we have the exclusive details of the 1997 MTV Europe Music Awards. Janet Jackson talks about her new single. Mercury Music Prize winner Ronnie Size persuades us that the future is jungle. No Doubt take a break from touring for an exclusive chat. And the KLF reform as 2K and then split up again. The wheels have begun turning for the biggest music event in Europe this year, the 1997 MTV Europe Music Awards. At a special press conference on Wednesday, it was announced that the event will be held in the massive Ahoy Stadium in Rotterdam on the 6th of November. And if this, the fourth MTV Europe Music Awards, is anything like the last three, it'll certainly be a night to remember.
Plans have been unveiled for the European music event of the year, the 1997 MTV Europe Music Awards at the Ahoy Stadium in Rotterdam. The theme of this year's show will be an enchanted garden with U2, John Bon Jovi, the Spice Girls, Aerosmith, Backstreet Boys, and Joe Vanotti performing at the show on November the 6th. Nominations for the 13 categories were also announced. Oasis, the winner of last year's prestigious Best Group Award, have been nominated once again, along with U2, Radiohead, the Spice Girls, and the Prodigy. Björk, Madonna, Sheryl Crow, Toni Braxton, and Janet Jackson are all up for the Best Female Award, something that Janet is already nervous about.
Nervous? Yeah. Because you don't know. You don't know. I mean, it could be you, it could not be you. So there's this adrenaline that's just really, and all these butterflies in your stomach, and your palms are sweaty, and you hope it's you.
Last year's Best Male Artist, George Michael, faces tough competition this year from the likes of John Bon Jovi, Michael Jackson, Beck, and Babyface. Presenting this year's awards are some of the world's beautiful people, including Louise.
This is the first time for me. I've never, even in the eternal days, gone to an MTV Awards ceremony. So this is my first, so I'm looking forward to it. It'll be very nice.
Tickets for the show sold out within 2 hours. It's the first time in the event's history that music fans had the chance to get into the show itself.
The winner is Oasis.
And the winner is...
the Fugees.
Sorry, hello sir. Are you receiving me?
MTV, thank you.
Ronnie Size and his drum and bass project Represent have brought jungle to the world's attention this year with their groundbreaking album Lifeforms. The group won this year's Mercury Music Prize earlier this month and had the pleasure of beating the likes of Radiohead and Suede to win the coveted award.
In the end, we were agreed that the winner of the 1997 Mercury Music Prize is Ronnie Size with Represent for Lifeforms.
What this is about is, you know, a new music which has been, you know, innovated from this country, and I think that people can see the potential, and that is exciting. And I think that Mercury would have, you know, they want to make their mark and say, yeah, we recognise that, and I think they've done that. You know, by, you know, we won the award, man.
But for the Represent crew, winning the award is only the beginning. It's what happens next that really counts.
This was a spur to the people on now. I mean, people who are around our way, I mean, people who are struggling in the industry, people who need the boost, people who need the lift, people who just, you know what I mean, just who didn't think it could be done, who didn't really take the music that seriously. Now they're turning their heads and think, okay, let's give this thing the proper break now, treat it, you know, like the other music's out there, the other forms of music out there. You know, I mean, we're just musicians at the end of the day, trying to make people dance. Simple.
But making people dance is just one of Jungle's many abilities.
This music here, you know, it draws for its influences from, you know, from Quayback. You know, it draws from the influences of now, you know, and, you know, it gives you a vision of what it could be if you want it to be, you know what I mean? It allows you to go anywhere you want. It is something new, and it is something different, and it's got a lot of energy, and, you know, there's a lot of potential.
In fact, Jungle has so much potential that these days it seems to have outgrown its labels.
Drum and bass, Jungle, the two tags have both served their purpose. I think people need to get, you know, away from thinking too much about the actual tag and start looking at the, you know, the whole music as a, you know, the whole movement thing. You know, Goldie, he's got his own original sound. You know, people, you know, will soon be calling his Goldie music, or, you know, same with LTJ, he's got his own sound. You know, what we tried to do with Represent was to, you know, create our own sound, you know, to experiment, and not just one, but, you know, different sounds. The whole project is not just about one thing, it's about many different things, many different musical eras, many different musical styles. You know, it represents, you know, our past, and it represents what's going on right now.
And as far as Ronnie Size and Represent are concerned, their music has a bright future ahead of it as well.
I think that is early days, and, you know, we're not into overkill. We're not gonna, you know, we're just here to do, you know, our bit, and then, you know, there's a lot more that's gonna happen, but all in the right space of time. This is the first of many projects. You know, this is more like an introduction. It's like a book which hasn't been written yet. This music's the next rock. I think it's the next, you know, hip hop is the next, you know, whatever, electro. It's just a new music.
Those lovable ska fiends from the States no doubt are taking a well-deserved break from their third European tour. They've been on the road constantly for over 2 years now, but MTV got them to relax, put their feet up, and discuss the joys of being on tour and how European audiences are just as good as those in America.
In some ways, sometimes European audiences are even a little bit better. I don't know what it is, but sometimes they just seem a little freer with their feelings, and they don't mind going a little more nuts, a little extra nuts.
They just break out into their, you know, national song and take over. I was like, excuse me, I'm the singer, can you just, you know, I'm starting to get a little threatened by them. But no, they're definitely, you know, there's certain places that are crazy, like Italy and Spain. We had some amazing shows in England, actually.
The band's worldwide success has taken them by surprise.
We're surprised when we got our first song on the radio. You know, our band is, December will be 11 years. So we've been together a really long time, and just, we're always satisfied with what we were doing, because we always had people come to our shows, and it was on a small scale, but it was, you know, we just never really expected more than that.
Are there any girls here?
Singer Gwen Stefani, an icon to hundreds of Gwenabees around the world, has become a bit of a role model.
Take this big ribbon off my eyes, I'm exposed, it's a big surprise.
I in some ways feel a bit responsible, because only because our audience has gotten so young. I honestly can't really take on that responsibility, because I, you know, have a hard enough time kind of managing myself, let alone like all these teenage girls. But you know, it's, I guess that you have to kind of think about it a bit.
The band's hard work paid off this year when they won Best Group Video at the MTV Video Music Awards, which took them by surprise.
And the winner is...
No Doubt, Don't Speak!
It's more exciting than I thought it would be to win something like that.
But being on the road for 2 years solid has meant that writing new material has just had to take a back seat, but just for the moment.
We're not the type of band that can write a lot of music on the road. We're really wrapped up in the fact that we're on the road.
There's just not time during the day, and physically, like, my voice can only take so much, you know, singing and stuff. So today we were rehearsing, and me and Tom pulled out a few. We have about 7 songs that are, you know, infants that need to grow, and we're like going through them going, wow, they're kind of good, though. They're good. They need work, but we're really looking forward to it. We're going to be home at the end of November and probably start writing in December, January. And
with the huge success of the band's current album, Tragic Kingdom, and the enormous success of singles like Don't Speak and Just a Girl, the band don't seem to be under any pressure to follow that success up.
You know, we can't concern ourselves with whether it's going to be a hit on the radio or anything like that.
We've never done that before, so.
Yeah, it's, if it happens, great. If it doesn't, you know, believe me, we're not going to be disappointed.
We've had our cake and eaten it 5 million times, so it's like, we're full. We don't get any more. You know, good ending.
Boyz II Men's latest single, 4 Seasons of Loneliness, is, yes, you've guessed it, a love song. But writing love songs is simply what the boys are best at. And as they explained to us recently, this one in particular is very special to the group.
This song, basically talking about love with someone that you were really in love with. And you were with those persons, loving, with those, you know, that person, loving them for all of the seasons, and for some reason the relationship isn't there anymore, and you constantly remember the love that you had, and it doesn't allow you to move on, and it's basically, you know it lends a visual in the video and things like that too, like, you know, the evolutionary change that, you know, through the changing of the seasons, and you know, it shows a different side of Boyz II Men. And it's just, you know, the song, it really means a lot to us. It's a feeling song, and it's really beautiful.
Well, that's it for the first half of the show, but don't go far, because coming up in part two, we take a look at the new face of dance music. Janet Jackson explains her latest video. Dave Gunn gets himself out of trouble. And for one night only, the KLF form a new band.
This weekend, 3
top 100 videos of the 90s.
Number 86.
Hosted by Hanson.
Hanson.
Number 6.
101 reasons why you should watch.
100.
Top 100 weekend of the 90s.
Number 51.
Top 100 weekend. This weekend.
Sponsored by Fila and Suzuki.
When he took on the face of his son's killer, the killer took his. Now, bad never had it so good. John Travolta, Nicolas Cage.
What a predicament.
Face Off.
What happens when you play Dance Party? With the 60 greatest dance hits of all time. By artists like M People, Donna Summer, Snap, the Bee Gees, and Take That. That's 4 hours worth of original hits on 4 CDs or cassettes. But you can't buy Dance Party in the shops. You have to order it by phone. So, what happens when you play Dance Party? Call now and find out for yourself. Insight and Polygram. We know great music when we hear it.
Middle of Nowhere, the debut album from Hanson, includes a new single, Where's the Love? And the number one hit, Mmbop. Hanson, Middle of Nowhere, out now.
Welcome back to the weekend edition. Coming your way in this half of the show, Elton John breaks all the records, the KLF make a bit of history, and we take a look at the state of dance music today. But first,
news this week.
Goodbye, Elton John's tribute song to Diana, Princess of Wales, Candle in the Wind, has entered charts across Europe at number one. The track has become the fastest selling single in history, selling over 650,000 copies in the UK alone on the first day of its release. Many record shops across Europe have been unable to keep up with the demand, and thousands of additional copies have had to be pressed. Drug charges filed against Depeche Mode's frontman Dave Gahan have been dismissed by a US judge who's convinced that the star is now clean. Gahan faced charges for possession of cocaine and heroin after he allegedly took a drug overdose at a West Hollywood hotel on May the 28th, 1996. Since then, though, the star has been on an intensive drug rehabilitation program, proving his commitment to getting off drugs.
You know, I was sick and tired of feeling like that. I was sick and tired of waking up in the morning and knowing that I couldn't escape, or thinking that I couldn't escape, you know. It's that kind of lifestyle is, you know, at some point you've got to either try and arrest it or you're going to die, you know.
Spice Girls mania reached new extremes this week at a pop memorabilia auction in London, when fans from all over the world bidded for outfits worn by the girls. One eager Spice collector spent almost $9,000 on a busty pink number worn by Ginger Spice, whilst Baby Spice's clothes fetched $4,000. But the highlight of the auction was to be a 1972 BMW driven by former Beatle George Harrison, which was expected to raise over $18,000. Unfortunately, the car never did get sold, as it caught fire on the way to the venue. Britain's rock superstars have raised over $1.5 million for the people of the volcano-stricken island of Montserrat in a one-off mega gig. The artist lineup at London's Royal Albert Hall was the most star-studded since the 1985 Live Aid concert, featuring Sir Paul McCartney, Sting and Elton John. Each of the stars performed some of their own material, but they couldn't resist collaborating on a number of tracks, such as this old favorite from Mark Knopfler, Sting, Eric Clapton and Phil Collins. Finally, 6 months pregnant, Pamela Anderson has apparently told the American press that she's insisting husband Tommy Lee gets a vasectomy without anesthetic. Having given birth to her first child, Brandon, naturally, Pamela, according to the reports, now wants Tommy to grin and bear it too. The couple already know their second child will be a boy, and they're naming him Dylan Jagger. These days, dance music has become big business. The likes of Prodigy, Underworld, and the Chemical Brothers have all brought their own brand of techno into the charts. And even the Americans have caught on to it, though over there they've decided to call it electronica. But as this once underground music becomes the new rock and roll, we take a look and see whether hype has become more important than the songs.
It's a live thing. It's about being... It's given
large.
Large. L-A-R-G-E.
It's really about being large.
As once faceless electronica artists leap from the underground to the mainstream, their stage shows and their personas are swelling. As the scene shifts from clubs to more visual media outlets, acts like Prodigy and the Chemical Brothers are gaining success by putting their best face forward, leaving some purists wondering if the music is taking a back seat to the look.
I think that's like a lot of BS. When we're growing up, when we liked a band, we'd like to know more about them, what they look like, how they dress, and, you know, what's their favorite TV show or whatever, you know, I think that's natural.
And pop music's always been about personality and music. It's the kind of combination of the two.
We're not doing anything really to, you know, jump out and be publicity hounds, but at the same time, we're not hiding either. You know, we're not wearing masks or anything.
No, that would be the French duo Daft Punk. They lead a legion of reclusive artists who are intent on remaining faceless in the press and in their videos.
To be basically anonymous and dance kind of orientated is kind of exciting on an underground level, but when it comes to actual selling records, we're trying to get personalities and kind of integrity.
And while it may be true that image helps sell records, it's still the music, not the marketing, that matters most.
Labels and whatever, publicists or promo people, they really think they've got to set up everything and try to tell people before they hear it, okay, it's going to be this and it's going to be that, but okay, but I mean, we find you just play the music.
I just always consider myself just some mutant mucking around in this bedroom. That's what I'll always see myself as. I just somehow managed to make a really good career out of it.
Janis back and she's looking good. Miss Jackson has just been nominated for Best Female Artist in the 1997 MTV Europe Music Awards, and with a new single, Got Till It's Gone, she's set for another worldwide hit. It's a beautiful track, but it's one with an important message, which Janet hopes she portrayed in her video.
Here you have a group of people, it's doing a video where people are just having a good time. But the twist on it was it being in South Africa. And here you have people that aren't thinking about what's going on outside. They're forgetting all those worries, all the pain, and just enjoying the night and having a great time. And at the very end, when the bottle smashes against the sign that says Europeans only, Slaves Blankies, which is whites only, that says a lot. And with the bottle hitting it, it's I've always been one that's been against racism and tried to break those color lines. Always fought for that. I think it's important.
Strange things have been happening in London. In fact, one of the weirdest events in musical history occurred last Wednesday when Jimmy Cauty and Bill Drummond, both former members of chart-topping band The KLF and famous for burning £1 million, formed a new group for 23 minutes and then split up. A clever criticism of today's bands? An ingenious artistic statement? Or just a load of old hype? MTV's Eddie Temple Morris went along to find out what on earth's been going on.
A brief history of Bill Drummond and Jimmy Cauty, alias KLF, the greatest rave band in the world ever. January 1987, they formed Justified Ancients of Moo Moo. They didn't rock, they raved. In 1988, they changed their name to the Time Lords, and their rave classic, Doctoring the TARDIS, topped the charts around Europe. 89 and through the early 90s, now operating as the KLF, that's the Copyright Liberation Front, they had a string of worldwide hits with 3 AM Eternal, What Time Is Love, and Justified and Ancient with country star Tammy Wynette. Then when they won Brit Award for Best Band in 92, they hijacked the ceremony with machine guns and threatened to cover the audience in sheep's blood before the audience heard this voice.
Ladies and gentlemen, the KLF have now left the music business.
So that's pop sorted, art next, and they formed the K Foundation, gave a £40,000 prize for the worst piece of art in the UK to the same woman who won the Turner Prize for the best piece of art at £20,000. She didn't want it, but the K Foundation said if she didn't take it, they'd burn the £40,000. Now comes the really mad bit. They took £1 million in cash they'd hoarded from their pop days, took it to a small island off Scotland, and burnt it. What next, you may ask? Well, with the year 2000 coming up, you could rely on these guys to do something different. Shrouded in secrecy since it was announced, this week they held a 23-minute performance under the name of 2K, the year 2000, if you will. They filled the Barbican Hall in London with fans and music business alike, all gagging to know what these two were going to pull off this time. In true KLF fashion, even their own spokesman didn't know what Drummond and Courty would do on the night, and this is minutes before they're due to go on stage.
The good part about working with Bill and Jimmy, whether they're calling the KLF, the K Foundation, or 2K, is that they never quite let us in on what's going on.
Familiar clues to the KLF roots included those famous head horns, oh, and that 23-minute version of What Time Is Love. The performance included real lifeboatmen and the actual Liverpool dockers who've been fighting the British government since they lost their jobs years ago. With the 23 minutes up and the curtain about to fall, reaction in the crowd was good. Words like provocative and brilliant were bouncing around the hall, and another chapter in the history of the Justified Ancients of Moo Moo was closing. Or was it? The very next morning, staff arriving at the Festival Theatre on the River Thames, one of the most famous landmarks in London, were horrified to see this painted in huge letters on their beloved structure. Less the KLF have left the building, more the KLF have left something on the building.
Well, that's your lot for this week, but don't forget to tune in next weekend when we'll have another star-packed show for your enjoyment. See you then. Bye-bye.
This is gonna blow you away.